Let me put this as an example. Those are several of the German firms that have an operation in Costa Rica. Those firms are part of a larger cluster of several areas: technology, medical appliances, pharmaceuticals, and so on, logistics as well. And those operate in Costa Rica within a larger cluster. This cluster also is linked with many of the leading companies in technology, from edge technology to cloud technology to data analysis. And we have quite a vibrant cluster developing what's reaching the market and changing the way we perceive things and making growth happen. And there is a very specific part of Costa Ricans that benefit from it because they are researchers, they are employees, they work within this cluster in the very, very edge, let's call it, of those developments. Those people are bilingual or multilingual. Those workers, Costa Rican workers, are educated, they have formal jobs, they have higher degrees of welfare and well-being. At the same time, these being very, very relevant for our economy, for our growth, for our future, at the same time, we coexist at the same place, space, and time with 20% of poverty still, and 6% of extreme poverty. People with low schooling and not necessarily with all the opportunities. This to mention of how we are producing now. And one of the greatest challenges is that currently, for example, our unemployment, it's not explained because of the lack of job opportunities. Actually, this cluster is demanding more labor force. But what explains our unemployment currently, which is at 10% and it's high for us, it's explained because of skills and educations and how we get to give the opportunities to many people to be part of this cluster or other successful clusters as tourism or clusters such as the one of agri-tech, adding value to agriculture. So one of my first things is we have two realities coexisting. This in technology, this in labor opportunities, but somehow those these realities express as well in other fields. And one of the fields where you can show the results of this is also of how people express through democracies. Because inequality is also expressing through how people vote and how they perceive reality. I'm thinking with this, I'm putting a scenario that's, let's call it at this time, gray. But there are great opportunities as well, what we can do with digitalization and technology for the people. I want to share this example. And this comes from using technology in the public sector, and this comes from the health sector. Costa Rica developed in the past years this digital medical record system we call EDUS. We have a centralized national health system. Our life expectancy is reaching about 80 years old per citizen because it's been a successful system to protect all of our citizens. This won recently, in the last weeks, the United Nations Public Service Award. It's a digital system which has digitally a file for each and every one of the citizens throughout the 23 public hospitals all around the country, all the clinics, and all the first level services. This means we have the health information of the whole population, which is very good in terms of treating people, providing better diagnostics, prevention, but also represent a huge possibility in terms of data analysis and on future developments. And also has to be very well protected because it has lots of sensitive information of individuals. But having that data protected, the possible developments through the consolidation of that information provides a great opportunity linked with digitalization, artificial intelligence, and the medical devices industry to come up from a country such as Costa Rica with new developments for the whole health system, but to benefit the whole of the population. Let's remember, this is a public tool, and it's meant to provide health not only for those who can pay for it, but for the whole of the population. And this is the possibilities that digitalization can provide to our countries. Another example, and this is also recent, this is the hydroelectrical Reventazón project. This is the second largest infrastructure in Central America, just beside the Panama Canal. And it's one of the major sites of production of clean, renewable electricity in Costa Rica. 99% of our electricity is clean and renewable. That means we do not rely for our electricity in fossil fuels. This is part of how we make it. This is how we have achieved that. Obviously, this plant is also digitalized to make a better performance of how it works. But now one of the potentials with many of the partners, some of here that we've discussed in Germany, is that with this, we can also have the potential to produce green hydrogen. That means hydrogen that we can produce from clean renewable sources and can use in different industries. And that's one of the steps we're moving forward. By the way, this is also a public hydroelectric that's worked from the Costa Rican government, and that we are aiming to have public-private alliances to look for new developments. Why I'm mentioning this? Because these are also possibilities of how we can spread the benefits of digitalization, of jobs related to climate change and how we address it, and the possibilities we're facing and we have ahead. If I have to think about digitalization, climate change, and what we are facing now as societies, I think we have to link it with inequality, desigualdad. In those worlds that coexist, there are many who are included in digitalization, education, in job opportunity, and a few kilometers from there are many who are in extreme poverty. For me, it's clear why democracies are having these extreme debates. Because for one part of that populations, it's evident how, for example, climate change is the threat for the whole of the humanity. There's a vibrant movement, lots of young people moving in that direction. Us as a government, we just launched in February a national decarbonization plan. So in 2050, Costa Rica eliminates completely the usage of fossil fuels, not only in transportation, but in production and in agriculture and in residues and in freights. And for more part of the society, that's very relevant. But for another part of the society, those concerns are intangible. They feel those do not address their more close needs. And on the contrary, working on that is being far away from their needs. When I was coming here, I received some criticism regarding that. Decarbonization and gay rights, they told me, it's the highest concern of our government. They should be concerned about employment. So are those not connected at all? We should take the debate also on climate change and digitalization to the field of opportunities, addressing inequality. The question is also how? In Costa Rica, we have a long way to go, but there are several things that have helped us to address this. For example, 70 years ago, we abolished the army. We have no armed forces whatsoever. And that resources, or those resources, we use in education. Perhaps education for the whole of the population with a high quality standard for everybody, not for some people. It's one of the key elements that could help people be part of the fourth industrial revolution and also be concerned and aware about the problem that climate change represents. So instead of expending lots of billions of euros or dollars or yens in military spending, we should be educating more people to make a more inclusive society. Also addressing the innovation to address climate change. And there is a lot to be done there, but there are also lots of job opportunities. And we can use artificial intelligence, blockchain, we can use data analysis, we can improve our technologies for our innovation to do it. And there is lots of possibilities there also for inclusion. And I do believe that is possible, but that requires courage and action. There's one example from history that I love to quote, and I think here is it's a great place to quote it. And I read it the past December while trying to have some vacation. I was reading history of your marvelous country, of Germany, and it's in one passage it mentioned that in the 1920s there was a young mayor in Cologne. And at the time, in the 1920s, he stated that the peace and future of the communities in the Rim of Germany and of France, particularly, depended on and relied on working together and making peace and progress happen. He said that in the 1920s. The key thing is that that idea, that sole idea, was there present and could have been predominant. That young mayor in the 1950s became the chancellor of Germany. It was Konrad Adenauer. And he started the steel and carbon society, which is the base now of European Union. But what's the insight? The idea was there 30 years ago. And then it was made possible. The great ideas and the courageous ideas we have now ought to be true in order to make the world a better place. So why not cut spending in military for education? Why not address inclusion at the center of climate change and of digitalization to make real change? Because that's also on the basis of democracy. Inequality reflected on the debates of climate change, and inequality reflected on the access of technologies might be the key question of the future of our Western democracies, which we all know now that are being pressed on the public debates. So if there's a thought I want to share was that related to democracy. I also like to share this one because I think it has lots of strong insight on what we're facing. We don't inherit the earth from our ancestors. We borrow it from our children, and that's what we are facing now.